You've now come out as anti-Trump, and this has become your calling card in the political world. How did you get to your anti-Trump stance?
My anti-Trump. Oh, yes, okay, my anti-Trump stance. I didn't want to get involved with it at all. And somehow Trump forces everybody into this narrative that's about him. And I guess it started happening really soon after he announced he was running for president in the summer of 2015. When he came down that escalator in the Trump Tower. And I began to become interested in how he was being covered. I can't say I was particularly that interested in Trump. Of course, I'd known about him since he emerged on the scene, and I even wrote about him in American Psycho, where he is Patrick Bateman's father figure, where Patrick Bateman keeps wanting to meet Trump, wanting to see him, wanting to know what restaurants Trump likes. It's throughout the book. Trump is mentioned about 40 times in the book. And that was because when I was doing research on the book and I was hanging out with those guys on Wall Street, they all loved Trump. And it was something that was really, really kind of unsettling. They'd all read The Art of the Deal. He was this aspirational figure. He had, you know, this, you know, beautiful women hanging on to him. He had this lifestyle that they all wanted to emulate. And I thought it was amusing to put him in American Psycho. But that was really about all that interested me about Trump. Sure, I watched The Apprentice, which I somewhat enjoyed, and I followed his marriages and his children growing up. But I really didn't think that I'd have to engage with him on the level that we all had to. And I began to see how he was being covered in the summer of 2015 and into 2016. And there was this disconnect between who I thought Trump was and what he was trying to do and how the media was covering him. And it was disturbing, and it was bothering me enough that I started to talk about it on my podcast. I also live with someone who is about as far left as you can go. I would say borderline communist, millennial. And he and his overreaction to Trump also was troubling to me. I just couldn't understand how Trump could make people melt down and freak out in the way that some of them did. And I talk about this a lot in White, especially the elites that I've written about most of my life in my fiction, having dinner with them and seeing them, you know, get really incensed over the idea of Trump. And I'm talking about months, sometimes a year after the election. And it was, I started talking about how I guess I was anti-Trump, but that doesn't necessarily mean that I was pro-Trump. And I was never a Trump supporter. I didn't vote for him. But there was something so bothersome, so high-pitched and hysterical about the reaction to him that it was, quite frankly, beyond annoying. And that's covered in White, and I talk about this a lot on my podcast. What is it about Trump that causes such massive TDS?
The impression that I get for a lot of these folks is they consider themselves sophisticate, and here comes along this kind of boorish fellow from New York who doesn't play by any of their niceties, and it's like they mask their hatred for the affectation with a hatred for his supposed politics. So remember, I was sitting at some lunch with David Mamet, actually, and we were in, you know, the middle of Santa Monica. It's a beautiful day outside, and it's the middle of the day, and yet in Santa Monica, everybody can take lunch off, so everybody's enjoying themselves, right, having a $200 bottle of wine. And we're talking about Trump, and we're noting to each other that if we said his name, people would pretty much start screaming aloud and talking about how the end of the world was nigh in the middle of this beautiful restaurant in Santa Monica, because they just had to save America. And it's just, it is bewildering living out here, and you deal with these folks a lot more than I do in Hollywood, but this notion that they're saving the world by being part of the resistance, where is this coming from?
That's a very good question. And it has to stem from something about, I truly believe this, Trump's aesthetics. I'm not even sure if it's his policies. I'm not even sure if it's even whatever ideology he might or might not carry with him. It really seems to be aesthetics. It seems to be that this boorish clown, walked into the China shop and started knocking things all over the place with his orange skin and his weird hair and his, this kind of persona that Look, I have always said you just cannot take Trump literally. If you take Trump literally, your head is going to explode. You've got to understand the overall message that Trump is putting out there. Because in a lot of ways, he is really transparent. He is a transparent person on one level, even if he lies a lot. And you have to be able to juggle that and understand, okay, I get that when he's saying this, he's actually meaning this. When he's saying this, he's actually meaning this. So if you're going to let this aesthetic really throw you so off course, then you've really got to, take a big stiff drink at the bar and start realigning how you feel about this person. Because it what you're reacting towards and how strongly you're reacting about it is just, there's a disconnect. Also, he doesn't care. I believe he doesn't care. I know everyone says, oh, this is really getting to Trump. This is really going to upset him. This is really... I don't know how much. And I also don't know how much the resistance really interests him at all. I mean, I don't know how much he listens to the resistance. But getting back to what you're talking about, I really believe it all stems from how he looks and how he acts. And maybe it was in a package like Mitt Romney, right. Maybe it'd be easier to take.